The march of scientific discovery continues, and once again, there is no shortage of new information for this month. So here are 10 interesting scientific discoveries for October of 2023. Number 10, the star with two faces. Stars tend to be pretty homogeneous things, showing spectra that show an overall composition that doesn't really change much depending on what side of the star you're seeing. But a recent discovery has shown that at least for a white dwarf, this doesn't have to be the case. Nicknamed Janus after the Roman god that sported two faces, researchers at the Zwicky Transient Facility in California found that the star was very strangely differentiated. One side of the star is composed of hydrogen, and the other side of helium. Located 1,300 light-years away, it actually fits in a model of white dwarfs where they can transition between hydrogen and helium, and this one was caught in the act. This involves magnetic fields, and it may be that in the case of this star, the field is lopsided, causing the differentiation. This would mess with the star's convection unevenly and produce the effect, though aspects of this are still very much unclear. Weirdly, you would actually see this visually if you were in the star system, as the two halves of the star would show a brightness difference of about 15%, though overall the star would be much brighter than the sun anyway, due to its maintaining a higher temperature. A very odd star indeed. Number 9. Predicting earthquakes with the GPS system. Predicting earthquakes has been notoriously difficult. There was a time when it was thought that it would be very unlikely for us to ever be able to predict earthquakes. They are chaotic, and you never know when they're going to occur. And you can just know that certain areas are prone to earthquakes, and the longer the wait, the more chance an earthquake will occur. But in recent decades, there have been hints that there might be precursor events to earthquakes that might offer some hope of being able to predict them ahead of time. And we may now be able to do this thanks to the GPS system. We're going to need a much more sensitive system than what we have now to do it, on the order of 100 times more sensitive, but recent studies have shown that gradual but accelerating slips in land movement can be detected by the GPS system and may give up to 2 hours of warning that an earthquake is about to occur. The problem is that they used a huge overall data set, and the resolution is not yet there to do it for individual earthquakes. But as technology advances, it may end up being possible to predict at least some earthquakes and give those living in the areas some advanced warning. Number 8. Weird radioactivity on the moon. We know and see clear evidence of the moon's wild past volcanism all over the moon. You can see what once were great lava fields just by looking at the moon at night. Equally interesting, but until recently invisible to us, was the far side of the moon and the features it presents due to tidal locking with Earth. The far side has proven as interesting and enigmatic as the side we see, and it too sported volcanism, but in a different way and to a different degree generally than the familiar side. In this case, there is evidence of an area known as Compton, Belokovich, on the far side that exhibits strange topography, but also elevated levels of radioactive thorium. Taken from the data of China's Chang'e 1 and 2 orbiters, has shown that in this area it is unusually warm for the surface of the moon, explained by the decay of thorium and uranium. The only way to get this is past volcanism welling up these heavy metals from deep below the surface. But what we see is only a very tiny part of this upwelling. Deep below is a column of former lava that's solidified and is rich in these radioactive elements inside of a matrix of a type of granite called a batholith, making for one of the most active former volcanic areas on the moon being located on the far side, and is quietly warming it with radioactive heat. Number 7. Nerve clusters and consciousness. One of the great mysteries of the brain and indeed the universe is the phenomenon of consciousness. We still don't know how it emerges, but we do know that we can go to sleep, and we can also get knocked out, and also suffer injuries to the brain that impede it, however it works. But we do know that consciousness does seem to have two components, distinct but integral to each other, awareness and being awake. Researchers at Harvard have recently mapped out clusters of nerve cells located in areas of the brains in animals and human cadavers that found that they do connect, starting in near the brainstem in clusters previously associated with wakefulness and how they connect with clusters in the central brain, and then to clusters in the outer brain, which is associated with awareness. Using a sample of living humans to further the research, they were able to show how electrical signals travel from all of these clusters and interact. This may give clues as to what consciousness really is, though it's still early in the game. But what it might do in the near term is help doctors better understand a variety of psychiatric conditions, neurological diseases, and even coma after surgery or injury. Number 6. Flies apparently like to play. Fruit flies are not a lot of people's particularly favorite insect, especially if they get into a house. But at the same time, they are very interesting creatures in their own right. But what's always been unclear about the insect world is what sort of behaviors they share with the rest of complex life on Earth. And trust me, the insects are well represented on the complex side of things. One interesting question is play. We see playful activity in a huge variety of life on this planet. It's easy to see in dogs, cats, gorillas, and a host of mammals engaging in forms of play. We certainly do. From infancy to just tinkering with something frivolous like a Rubik's Cube, which are the bane of my existence, I can never solve them, to playing a good game on a computer or gaming console. Which incidentally, my current game is a playthrough of the Callisto Protocol, which is alright, but not so great on the hard science. But the big question floating around was, do the insects also play? It turns out, yes. Research into bumblebees showed evidence that they will play with wooden spheres that they can roll around. One wonders how widespread this is. Do the spiders play? But right now it's the fruit flies, and they like to take rides on spinning carousels. Researchers at the University of Leipzig in Germany did a series of experiments involving food and moving and non-moving carousels. The flies that landed on spinning carousels spent significantly more time sitting on it while it spun than the ones that landed on a stationary carousel. You'd think that if it was unpleasant to sit on a spinning carousel, the flies would just avoid landing on it altogether. But no, many of them flocked to it and seemed to enjoy it and hang around, but some percentage avoided it. Perhaps motion sickness is also a thing in the insect world. Number 5. Europa is leaking carbon dioxide. There's no question that Europa is one of the most interesting objects in the solar system, a very ancient object dating from the early days of the solar system that seems to have sustained a liquid water ocean beneath its surface of ice for a very long time. That might provide an abode for life, but it's still very unclear if it really can. We just don't have enough data to establish if there isn't some fatal aspect of that subsurface ocean that precludes it from having the conditions for life to arise. But the hints that it does are mounting, and one very important one has recently been discovered. In short, Europa's ocean is leaking carbon dioxide into space. This is actually a recent James Webb Space Telescope discovery. Observations have shown that CO2 is leaking into space, especially from a region called Terra Regio, which shows very broken up, chaotic terrain where cracks may lead directly to the ocean below. This is also a relatively young area of Europa's surface, just a few million years, showing that the surface of that moon is interacting recently with the ocean below. But there are so-called areas of chaos terrain which are also showing elevated levels of carbon dioxide, making it less likely that the source was comets instead of the subsurface ocean. But this is not an indicator of life in that ocean. Rather, it's simply an indicator that Europa's ocean likely has lots of carbon in it, which is essential for life. It has the main component for carbon-based biochemistry, but it does tick a box and bolster the cause to look more deeply for life in the waters of that moon. Number 4. Updates on the Dimorphos collision. One of the highlights of the year 2022 was the impact of NASA's DART mission into the asteroid Dimorphos to see if we could deflect it, or in this case, slow the small asteroid's orbit of its larger parent asteroid Didymos. This was a proof of concept, because the basic physics of impacting objects are quite predictive, though there can be anomalies if you don't know every single factor. In this case, it was a success, slowing Dimorphos' orbital period by 33 minutes. Interestingly, this is also a case where citizen science has helped to further our understanding of what happened, and it actually created a mystery. This was undertaken by a high school teacher and students at a school equipped with a 0.7-meter telescope that was able to resolve the two asteroids. The weird thing they found is that after the initial collision, the orbit of Dimorphos has since moved a full minute to 34 minutes. This is rather large, actually. The slowing of the orbit may be due to Dimorphos having been previously tightly locked to Didymos, and her impact upset the apple cart and sent it into an irregular state, which there is some evidence for. What might have happened is that the impact caused the asteroid to start liberating, rocking, in short, which our own moon does. But in this case, it may have cascaded and caused Dimorphos to go chaotic and evolve into outright tumbling, which the gravitational forces being upset by this would be responsible for the further minute of slowdown. But a more likely explanation is that huge rocks were kicked up by the impact, and as they fell back, they affected the orbit. More recent research that's being done might better support this, that there was a plateauing shortly after impact that would be consistent with material falling back onto the surface of Dimorphos. This, however, eventually will be better understood and the question probably laid to rest as the ESA Hera mission will arrive at Dimorphos in 2026 to make observations of the aftermath. This will be important though, as this is our first real step at asteroid deflection, which will hopefully make humanity immune from asteroid extinction events from here on out. Number 3. The mysterious Helium-3 where it should not be. Helium-3 has been the subject of much discussion over the years because of the potential for lunar mining. The lunar soil contains a fair amount of Helium-3, which has been presented as an excellent fuel for fusion energy, though the reality of that is more complicated than is often presented. We can probably use it, yes. The science is there in principle. But actually making that reality first comes up against how we're pursuing fusion technology, but also that Helium-3, while it could be mined and returned from the moon, is actually not that abundant. Any mining operation would need to sift through 150 tons of regolith just to get a gram of Helium-3. That said, you don't need that much of it returned per year to Earth to power the whole planet, and you definitely could run a lunar colony on it. But we won't be doing that with the earthly supply. Earth does have helium, but not a lot of it. It's a resource we should not be wasting because we will run out. And most of it is Helium-4. So Helium-3 doesn't really factor in, though the Earth's mantle does contain it, left over from its formation. Helium-3 is really more a matter of objects in space, which is how it's generated. But what you really shouldn't find is Helium-3 on Earth that's out of place. Yet it's been known since the 1990s that detectable Helium-3 exists in certain strata from the seafloor, and it's long been a mystery as to how it got there. This may now be answered, however, and the answer is a bit spooky. The deposit dates to roughly 33 million years ago. This coincides with the age of two large impact craters on Earth, one in Russia and one in the US. What might have happened here is that both the Earth and the Moon were hit by a shower of projectiles, maybe a broken up asteroid or comet, and the impacts on the Moon stirred up the regolith and its Helium-3 and threw it into space. It was large enough to survive entry into the atmosphere of Earth and settled in a layer. Interestingly, this research may be backed up by a lack of iridium. Typically, iridium is one of the things you look for in impacts. The great dinosaur killer Yucatan impact resulted in the famous iridium-rich layer found in Earth's geology. But in this 33 million-year-old layer, you see the Helium-3, but not high iridium. The moon's surface is low in iridium, which would be consistent with a lunar origin for this Helium-3 deposit. Number 2. The very real underwater effects of volcanoes has gotten worse. There's no question that volcanoes are among Earth's greatest destructive forces. Populated areas near volcanoes are always in danger, and they can devastate areas for many years, such as what happened with the outright explosion of Mount St. Helens. Something yours truly witnessed as a little kid from across the Columbia River in Oregon on May 18, 1980. It's not something I could ever forget, and the devastating aftermath on the forests and the lakes surrounding it is evident to this day. Worldwide volcanoes remain a force to be reckoned with in seismic zones, but it's not just the surface of the Earth, but also the ocean floor that sees destruction on a human scale. In 2022, the eruption of the Hunga Haapai volcano of Tonga exhibited an enormous underwater volcanic flow of a type that wasn't really known about. Volcanoes can produce pyroclastic flows, enormous fast-moving flows of hot ash and gas moving down mountainsides, destroying everything in their path. These currents are enormously hot and are what baked and destroyed Herculaneum in the eruption of Mount Vesuvius in 79 AD. In this phenomenon is something known as a pyroclastic density current, and this can apparently transfer to the ocean when a volcanic flow of this nature hits it, creating an underwater density current. It was known that this phenomenon could happen, but not on the scale of what Tonga's volcano did, which is currently the largest volcanic eruption of the 21st century. How this was mapped out and discovered was simple. It destroyed and cut hundreds of kilometers of telecommunications lines and caused massive changes to the seafloor that was exposed to it. In a volcanic event, the ocean does not always protect. Number 1. The Bennu Bonanza. To end this list on a high note is perhaps the most significant story in astronomy so far this year. The sample return mission from the asteroid Bennu has returned safely to Earth. Not only was the mission a success, it was a boon. What happened was the actual canister used to collect the samples was to collect up a sample of 60 grams of material from the surface of Bennu and then seal itself for return to Earth. And it did this successfully. The canister is still sealed and will be very carefully opened in a sterile environment and studied according to pre-planned procedures and experiments. But scientists on the OSIRIS-REx mission got more material than they bargained for. The canister sealed correctly, but outside it, the pipe running into it also collected quite a bit of bonus material. This extra material, being bonus material collected outside of the intended experiment, was available for immediate studies by researchers. And so far it's been found to contain water and carbon, which are required for life, giving more evidence that water and carbon compounds coming from space were integral for abiogenesis on Earth. Some component that became us, or all of it, may have come from out there, and that the bane of life on Earth, the impact event, also was responsible for life happening at all. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about the playing insects. I had to wonder with that entry, what the flies were like after the carousel stopped. Did they return to just flying around normally, or did they show signs of being dizzy? I'd love to know if there was any erratic flight or anything like that noted, but it wasn't mentioned. Dizzy flies, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.